Hi, my name is Kate Harrison. I'm a Board Certified Behavior Analyst and a Behavior Consultant with Brett DiNovi and Associates. Today, we're going to be talking about task number I-01 of the current 4th edition BACB task list. The BACB has identified defining behavior in observable and measurable terms as something clinicians in behavior analysis should be familiar with. Why is this important? Our job as behavior analysts is to improve socially significant behaviors. Cooper and colleagues state that the validity of scientific knowledge in its most basic form implies replication. If we aren't clear about exactly what we're measuring, we're going to have a pretty difficult time replicating it, tracking it, and convincing others that our interventions are effective. Have you ever been in a situation where you or your team assumed you all understood the behavior you were collecting data on? Let's take this example. A teacher expresses frustration with her students calling out and wants to see more hands raised before shouting out answers. Easy, right? You and your colleague go into her classroom for a couple of observations and collect some initial baseline data for raising hands. Back at the office, you review your data with each other and notice some pretty big discrepancies between your data and hers. It sounds like a case of poorly defined behaviors. You and your colleague clarify your definition and agree that raising hands is defined as any instance in which a child puts their hand in the air during instruction. For purposes of this example, let's pretend that you are reviewing tapes from the initial observation. After comparing the data from your second go at it, you and your colleague are still having trouble agreeing on the occurrences of hand raising. For example, your colleague tallied when little Joey raised his hand, but you did not because Joey yelled out the answer before the teacher called his name. So who's correct? Well, at this point, neither of you, because you still haven't defined hand raising operationally. Before we even think about developing an intervention, we've got to get on the same page for how we're going to measure it. It's time for a major definition cleanup. Let's review how to operationally define a behavior. Operational definitions are important not just for behavior analysis, but for any science. They increase accuracy, program effectiveness, and the ability for the practitioner to apply procedures consistently and fluently. When we're clear about the occurrence and non-occurrence of a target behavior, we're able to develop and monitor interventions that make meaningful changes in our clients' lives. So where do we start? First things first, let's remember the good old dead man's test. If a dead man can do it, it's not behavior. If a dead man cannot do it, then it is behavior. It's safe to say that a dead man is not able to raise his hand, but we can use this rule of thumb throughout the entire operational definition process. A few things to keep in mind when developing an operational definition for a target behavior. Your detailed definition must be 1. Clear and concise. Get straight to the point. Your definition should be easy to understand. You want your reader to become fluent with this definition. It should be able to give a lot of information with just a few words. 2. Objective. Your definition needs to represent observable and measurable events and be free of any personal opinions or feelings. And 3. Complete. Your definition should describe boundaries for what is and what is not included, reducing the need for any judgment calls. With these three tips in mind, we must also consider the functional implications of the behavior's effect on the environment. So in this case, what is the purpose of calling out? Is it to share the answer? Is it to ask for help or access the bathroom? Is it to make a joke to make peers laugh? This may require some further analysis. And the topographical implications. What's the behavior's shape or form? What does it look like? Does hand raising occur as a single instance, or does it occur for an extended duration of time? Does it include making vocalizations? And if a behavior is not listed in the operational definition, it can't be scored as an occurrence. Finally, remember that definitions should be individualized. For example, a greeting for one student might be a verbal, "Hey, how's it going?" and maybe just eye contact and a smile for another student. There are lots of questions to be asked when defining dependent variables, even the behaviors we consider to be simple. But the more detailed our definitions are, the greater chance we have for inter-observer agreement and ultimately developing a successful intervention. Let's give our hand-raising definition another try. Hand-raising in class is defined as any instance in which a student extends her arms straight above her head without a bend in the elbow towards the ceiling with fingers extended in an open palm until her name is called, or up to a duration of 10 seconds without making any vocalizations. One last tip, if you're fortunate enough to be working with a team, recruit someone to test your definition before applying it. It'll save you some time by identifying any confusion or discrepancies ahead of time, and it will allow you to be more effective in measuring the behavior and make meaningful, lasting changes. We'd like to hear from you. What did you think of this definition? Do you think you and your colleague may be able to get more inter-observer agreement of occurrence and non-occurrence of hand raising? What behaviors would be scored? Which ones wouldn't? Give it a test run and let us know in the comments below. Thanks for watching.